Good morning and welcome to our Sunday morning worship service. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you. Today we come together to remember before God Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, and we give thanks for his life and we comfort one another at this really sad time. We'll be praying for the royal family and particularly the Queen at this difficult time later on in our service. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. We move to a time of saying sorry to God and we pray our prayer of confession together. Our lives are often marked by fun and laughter, but underneath is our worry, our sorrow, our shame, our guilt, our grief. Let us hand all these things over to the one who does not tell us off, but offers us love and joy. In this moment, as my mind wanders, God, redirect my thoughts to you. In this week, as I walk your path and sometimes stumble, God, make your way clear. In our communities where we have sometimes remained silent, God, open our lips to speak for justice. In this world where there is much hurt, hurt that sometimes we cause, God, will you make us agents of healing? And in this time when there is much sorrow and grief, God, send us out to be ambassadors of hope and joy. And in these moments of silence, we bring before God those other things that we need forgiveness for today. God, will you hear our prayer? God's promise of forgiveness. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins and assure us of his eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we turn to our psalm of praise. Today, Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And we're going to listen now to John Rutter's This is the Day. Our Bible reading today is from John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hand and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our thought for today is brought to us by Richard Rohr. Richard is a priest, an author, and a particular author on spirituality. He's also a spiritual director and founder of Action and Contemplation. So I recommend getting hold of some of his books. They're wonderfully helpful in our journeys of faith. But now we're going to listen to his thought for the day.
I was able to speak from this pulpit 4 years ago. I'm very honored to be invited back. I hope my thoughts aren't too confusing. I've talked two times in a row now, and this is the third. And you always say, "Did I say that already? Or is that going to bore them to death?" But pray that I can help open this wonderful scripture for you. It's one of those scriptures that speaks for itself, stands on its own because it's so filled with magnificent metaphor and image, and yet it needs to be endlessly unpackaged because it is so rich. So let me try. But let me try to begin with the very last verse. It says, "These thoughts have been recorded to help you believe that Jesus is the Christ." Let's start with that. For those of you at the rector's forum, this is, of course, what I just talked about. That most of us were conflated the two words Jesus and Christ. Most of us, frankly, were trained to think that Christ was Jesus' last name. All right. This particular passage, as many of the sermons in Acts say it much better, Jesus revealed the Christ, Jesus became the Christ, Jesus proclaimed the Christ. So let's get that straight to begin with. In John's Gospel, which is mostly talking about the Christ, we're talking about a different archetype, image, teacher than Jesus, even though they become the same. And this early preaching is coming to that recognition. The Christ, and this is clear, so you don't think I'm preaching something untrue. This is clear in the prologue to John's Gospel, the hymn at the beginning of Colossians, the hymn at the beginning of Ephesians, the first paragraph of Hebrews, the first paragraph of 1 John. I have to cover all my bases. So you don't think I'm making something up, all right? They all say with absolute clarity, the Christ existed from all eternity. Jesus has only existed in time. 2,000 years ago. Now we who came along 2,000 years later, we just lumped the two together, Jesus Christ. Actually, It's one of the major Achilles heels in Christian theology, because to put it most concisely, most of us were taught or invited to fall in love with Jesus, but we weren't taught or invited to fall in love with the Christ. The Christ is a cosmic concept, and let me put it straightforwardly. The Christ is the Christian code word for reality, for everything. Jesus becomes the Christ, and in that includes in his journey that he walks for us and with us and in us, the classic archetypal human journey from conception, hidden conception in Bethlehem, to an ordinary life of 30 years like most of our lives are, where you hardly hear about him, to trial, betrayal, death, and resurrection. But this is a statement. Now listen closely. This is not just a one-time anomaly, and we Christians get all happy on Easter. Yay! God, the Father raised up Jesus. No, it's a statement about how reality works all the time, everywhere. And we're living in a most wonderful time where physics and astrophysics especially is proving this for us. Quite simply put, nothing dies. Everything is transformed, and the final chapter of history is resurrection. Now, this was always understood by the great Christian mystics, who were much more Trinitarian than most of us are. But we pulled Jesus out of the Trinity, tried to understand him as a standalone figure, whittled Jesus down, and unfortunately, that's why, to be perfectly blunt, we still have Christians who can be racists. We still have Christians who don't love the big mystery. They don't love the big truth. They don't love what Jesus calls the reign of God. We made Christianity into a tribal religion when it was meant to be a universal cosmic statement about how reality works. Jesus is, to use maybe later language, is the archetype, the corporate personality, the stand-in for everything. Suddenly, the Christian message has huge relevance for the life, but even more relevance for history. The other great flaw, it seems to me, that we've fallen into is to pull the gospel into an individual theory of how you can go to heaven, and you can go to heaven, and you can go to heaven or hell, or you can go to heaven or hell. What a sad story. And most people go to hell by our own rules, it seems. And you listen, you know, ever since the late great planet Earth and all this malarkey about Armageddon and apocalypse now, the final end of history was not resurrection. Quite the contrary. It was all sliding down to a tragic, tumultuous, and punitive ending. You see, when all of history isn't hopeful, when society isn't hopeful, and any of you who are therapists know this, it's very hard to heal individuals. It's very hard to make you hopeful, you hopeful, you hopeful, when the whole thing is going to hell in a handbasket. Do you see? Christianity was meant to be a cosmic message of hope for history. Now, with that, let's go back to the gospel text, and we're going to see what this final chapter of history looks like. What kind of God we really have. And of course, if we're created in the image of God, how we image God is rather important. If he's punitive, we can be punitive. If he's violent, we can be violent. But what we're going to have here appearing behind locked doors, by where they're hiding for fear of the Jews, here we have an image of all of history hiding, almost always out of fear. Look at our contemporary politics in this country. Most of it fear-based, because that's what appeals to the ego at the lowest level of motivation. In the evening of the first day of the week, the beginnings of a new creation, the first day of the week, the doors were locked. They were hiding for fear of the temple authorities. And Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, Shalom. The great Sabbath, the great peace of the Sabbath. And then he showed them the price of this transformative journey. He showed them the wounds in his hands and in his side. So we have Jesus, and let me just give two succinct words to how God, Jesus, is being presented to us. He is coming in the midst of history as the forgiving victim. Let me repeat it. The forgiving victim. Without it, we all play games of victimhood for our own aggrandizement, and there will be no new history. There will be no new day. And you see this in our world right now. People simply accumulating past grievances to give themselves moral high ground and the right to be violent because you did this to us. And here Jesus, who is betrayed by his own inner circle, abandoned by most of them except the three women at the foot of the cross and John, I said to the last group, if I had reappeared, I would have said, you idiots. How can you be so obtuse, you know? And all he says is, shalom. Doesn't even mention it. Doesn't even bring it up. This is a new day. This is a new history, which unfortunately has not been the majority of Christian history either. And not only does this new presence, this new availability of God crossing through locked doors even, but he breathes on them. Now, any of you who are students of Scripture know what this is connoting. Where did this last happen? Right at the beginning of the Bible, in the second chapter of Genesis, where Yahweh takes the mud of the earth and he breathes into it. So we clearly have a connotation of the new Adam. If Adam was the archetype of the first human being, as Paul says in several places, Christ is the corporate personality for the second transformed human being. And here we have a marvelous symbolic metaphorical statement of what transformation looks like. Because breath and spirit, Holy Spirit, and forgiveness are all equivalent. They're all the same thing. God is as available as the breath right in front of your mouth. God is always recreating humanity by this infusion of spirit, this infusion of love into the cold heart of Adam. And then to take it even further, and we call this the principle of incarnation. He knows that we're going to do exactly what we did, largely spiritualize this whole message. And he has to bring it down to earth. He has to bring it to embodiment. He has to bring it to physicality. Has to bring it to this world and the suffering that most of us go through in this world. And Thomas doesn't want to believe in a wounded God. He doesn't want to believe in a God who participates and is in solidarity with human suffering. And he says, you can't know what I'm talking about, Thomas, until you put your fingers inside my wounds. You've got to feel what it feels like for the poor, for the rejected, for the abandoned. Now you can believe. This is incarnational Christianity. This is not some bypassing of the human journey, but we have Jesus returning to some form of physicality, not fleeing into the heavens, but re-entering this world in a new way. And brothers and sisters, that's exactly the Jesus, exactly the Jesus you have access to today. In fact, this moment. It's the same Christ. It's the same presence. It's the same forgiving victim. It's the same shalom. And it's the breath you're taking in right now.
Let's join together now in prayer. The life-giving presence of the risen Lord is here. He was with the disciples as they began to realize that Jesus was present with them, whether they could see him or not. And we too experience his spiritual presence among us now, and we welcome him with joy. We join in prayer together, and we ask that God, you give us an increasing love between us, bring us closer together as a benefice, and help us to have increasing open-heartedness and generosity in spirit. life-giving Lord, reign in our hearts. We pray for the breaking down of suspicion, double standards and hypocrisy in our world, that the nations may work together to conquer problems, the problems of food and water distribution, so that our planet's resources are shared and not wasted. Life-giving Lord, reign in our hearts. And we pray for the homes and families represented in our church community, with all their practical issues, their joys and sorrows, their needs and resources, that our lives may be practical witnesses of our journey. Life-giving Lord, reign in our hearts. We pray for those who are in need of your healing and wholeness, all who are ill and injured, those undergoing surgery and those nearing death. And we pray for all those who have died in faith. May they rise to new life in glory. God of our lives, we give thanks for the life of Prince Philip, for the love he shared among us, and for his devotion to duty. We entrust him now to your love and mercy through our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we just take a moment to reflect on the life of the Duke of Edinburgh. I wonder what stands out in your memory about the Duke. I wonder what you will always remember about him. What things did you learn through his life and death, including about God? We'll just take a moment just to reflect on Prince Philip now. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." And we especially pray now for the Queen and all the members of the royal family. May they know the hope of your promises and the comfort of your love through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may Christ, our Lord, give us peace. Amen. We join together now in the prayer that our Saviour taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our final prayer of blessing. May the celebration of resurrected life bring new hope to your being. May the victory over earthly death turn your eyes to the promises of heaven. May the empty tomb help you to leave your sorrows at the foot of the cross, so that God's hope, promises and forgiveness reign in your life forever. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you, remain with you and those that you love, now and always. Amen. So go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. So God bless you and have a really good week.